Give a round of applause to welcome Miss Dorville, the Deputy Principal of Academics.
One very young and handsome speaker is Captain James Anthony Tan. Okay, let's give him a warm welcome.
How would you not love flying? It's the ultimate form of freedom. Let's give Captain James a big hand.
Well, my name is Captain James Tan. I'm the youngest person to circumnavigate around the world solo by aircraft. I have a Guinness Book of World Records, one Guinness Book of World Record, two World Record Academy Awards. First, I'm the Man of the Year 2013, and Malaysian Book of Records, I have two as well. So let me begin my journey. I have a lovely mother sitting right there, which sacrificed everything for me. You know, she drove me to KL and back because I suffer with dyslexia. I couldn't read until I was about 8 years old. So becoming a pilot was quite tricky. So why aviation? When I was 5 years old, I took a trip to the UK. And for the first time, I saw the 747. It was absolutely beautiful. I saw the captain with his four bars and with his hat. I was like, you know what, that's pretty cool. But the thing that turned my interest into passion was I saw a red fighter fly 90 degrees up in the air. And from there onwards, I wanted to become a pilot. So out of many, many sacrifices, many failures, one day I got into aviation college. And I'm happy to say I got a 92 average and a full first-time pass rates as well. But it wasn't easy. So it was me, fresh out of college, no experience, nothing. And I got a phone call from a British businessman. And his name was Mr. Roy Tomlinson, right here. He taught me this lesson in life. Life is relative. One man's dream is another man's reality. You must ask yourself, what is your dream and what is your passion? And once you find it, go for it. So this man here, he kept me waiting for about 5 hours in the middle of London. So I was waiting there for 5 hours. I called him like 1,000 times. But soon later he came. I had a quick 30-minute interview, and he gave me my first ever job to be his private pilot for his private aircraft, which is the SR-22 series. This was my first award from the Malaysian Book of Records. I flew this aircraft from UK to Bangkok and back. And that journey was absolutely amazing. I saw the variation in life and the changes that happens instantly within just a few hours of flight. And on my next slide, I'd like to show you a quick video of how it was done. Before that, you know, on the first flight, you know, I actually had a full exhaust valve failure. You know, the entire expedition almost ended. Then we needed to refuel the aircraft in India, Nagpur, which didn't have a fuel bowser, which didn't have a mechanical fuel pump. So we were like, how are we going to do this? How are we going to refuel this aircraft? So we actually hired a tractor and a trolley. We went out the apron, got a 200 liter barrel of jet fuel, took it all the way back to the aircraft and refilled it with a bucket. You know, it was amazing. It took us 3 hours to actually refill 80 gallons, but it was totally worth it. It was a great experience. I hope you guys enjoy this video. In this small little journey that took 26 days, okay, 26 days of endless travel, of endless fighting and arguing and pushing and pushing and pushing, I learned that life was relative and I was contemplating my life. And when I was sitting down in the middle of Oman, having a cup of coffee, watching the sunset, I saw this young boy. And I saw in this young man what I hope that I've never will see again. I saw in his eyes that he did not have passion. He did not have a dream. He did not have inspiration. He was empty inside. And that scared me because I knew if I did not have a loving mother right there, which sacrificed so much for me, or a great institution like Segi Colleges to assist us in our development, I would have become like him. That really scared me. I did not know. So I decided something. I want to do something great with my life. I want to be better. I want to improve myself. And I decided I'm going to do it. I am going to do it. So I decided to come up with 1RTW. Because that's the only way I know how to inspire people. Because that is my trade. That is my inch. And there she is. For 9 months, I went to every single sponsor you can think of. Everyone, you know. All my friends, which I thought were my friends, abandoned me, and people that I thought wasn't came to me. And after 9 months of rejection, of endless failure, every single time they said the same thing. You're too young, it's never gonna happen, you don't have enough time, you don't have enough money. So I decided to go to the one man in Malaysia that had the power to actually make this happen, which was the Prime Minister of Malaysia. I got an official endorsement from the Menteri Besar of Hulu Langat, which is my state. Woohoo! And I was able to get into the PMO, got lost for about 3 hours, because we got no idea where we were going, because it's like a maze. And we got dragged all over the place, and we got a meeting with Yayasan Felda. Felda helped us develop this program, and I was able to come up with 1RTW with a broader state. The day before my meeting with the Prime Minister, okay, I just made a brand new presentation, made a brand new letter, didn't even know I was meeting the man, and I stayed up to about 4:30, printing out everything, making sure everything was done, and I got a phone call at 10:30 telling me, James, come to Putrajaya ASAP. So I was like, okay, fine. So I just went to Putrajaya saying, who are we going to meet? We're meeting number one. Crap. So we got up there with the fifth floor, and in 20 minutes, I was able to convince the Prime Minister of Malaysia to give me his official endorsement. There wasn't any money involved, but official endorsement. That's all you need. And with that, I was able to get sponsorship. And with that, 1RTW became a reality. And Malaysia was on its road, new legacy. The legacy of a global Malaysia. I hope you enjoyed this video. thank you very much for that. So I was off after 9 months of failure and 20 minutes of success. That's all you need, actually. Life is moments, trust me in that. RTW became a reality. And not many people know this, but sooner or later, everyone's gonna know it. RTW almost ended on its first takeoff. I was so nervous that I actually overboosted the engine, and the engine almost burst in front of me. So take your time in the things that you do in your life. Trust me. And that was just the beginning. You know, we had 5 months of pre-preparation of endless finances, logistics, planning on different stages. You needed world permits, you needed world visas, you needed foreign currency, finance for fuel to send it foreignly as well, through actually bank transfers, which was near impossible because of Bank Negara. So it was just an amazing thing. And after that, we straight away started the expedition. In flight from Taiwan into Japan, I had 2.5 hours of IFR conditions. I was in a thunderstorm, and there was absolutely blackness outside. Raining, ice, lightning, turbulence. It was magnificent, and this is the view outside my entire cockpit. It turned into icing conditions, and it was just breathtaking, the way it was, you know. And this is my immersion suit. I know, it's, a lot of people call me like the Bomberman from like the old games, the Bomberman. So this suit here ensured my survival in case of a crash. Because when you go into the far north, the water goes down to about -5 and you get hypothermia very quickly. So you really, really need this kind of stuff. And outside, in the aircraft itself, because this is not a commercial aircraft. It is not built for like long distance flights. So it was, when I got into Siberia, it was -50 degrees Celsius outside my cockpit. And inside my cockpit, sitting down, it was about -10. And it was cold, you know. I got my beanie on, I got my scarf on, I got my jacket on, and I was still freezing. But the sights you see was unbelievable. In Siberia, as far as an eye can see, it's absolutely empty. There's no life. And this is the Bering Straits. The Bering Straits is a frozen ocean. It used to be a landmass crossing between Russia into the Americas. And I was the only living human being within 500 kilometers around me. And it was a scary feeling because I knew that I was absolutely alone in this. There's no one there, no one to back me up. If anything happened, I was by myself. This is the only time I was scared. There's a very interesting story about the Siberian crossing. I was crossing from Andrea into Anchorage, which is the far north. And it was so cold at night, my entire aircraft got frozen solid with ice. I couldn't open the door, I couldn't open the boots, I couldn't open the boot, everything was frozen solid. So I took a screwdriver and started scraping off the ice from my aircraft. I got a few scratches in there, but thank you, Felder. I needed to reconnect the battery because when you go to the far north, I know the engineering boys will actually know this, the batteries don't work. It's just too cold. Anything below -20, the batteries just don't work. There's not enough power, not enough juice in it. So I needed to reconnect the battery and actually put a ground power unit in it. I lost all feeling in my right hand. I was near hypothermia. I got in the aircraft, I started it, and I took off. You know, it took everything. I took off. So I was at about 21,000 feet, flying across the Bering Strait. You know, all by myself, shaking. Wondering why is it so cold? So because my mind was already slightly frozen, I swear. So I started playing with the heater. So I was like trying to figure out, is it on? I was doing that for about a good 20 minutes, and then I finally realized that I did not turn on the heater. Yeah. So this is a crossing from. January into Vancouver. Before this, I have a failed GPS unit, a failed radio, a flat tire, which I needed to replace in Russia. My engine was giving me a bit of a funny issue, but I fixed that already when I was in Russia. And so I was pretty tired, and I was pretty tired. Then now I get into Alaska and everything's frozen, which kind of really annoyed me. But I decided to continue because this is what you have to do. You have to persevere. You have to push your limits. Because once you cross that limit, there's another limit. It's just amazing, the sensation you feel. So I took off, and I was having a great flight. I was waiting for the gap because all around me was just tall mountains. So it is a VFR departure only. So I took off, went throughout it, and in a single flight, in 20 minutes, I lost one fuel pump, and I lost my landing gear as well. So I needed to do a mechanical pump to actually release the gears down. So I was really tired. My spirit was broken. It was broken. It really was. But then I reached the next stage. You know, thanks to the Ministry of Tourism, all men are cavemen. We really are. When we get depressed, we go back to our caves. True, brother. True. All right. And the Ministry of Tourism came to me and they took me out and said, James, what you're doing is not for yourself, but for everyone around you. Because when one Malaysian succeeds, we all succeed. This is how it is. They took me out and showed me the reason why I'm doing it. It is for the spirit of Malaysia, our legacy, that we can do it, Malaysia boleh. And I decided to have that more positive look in the world again, the more zestful side. And I saw the wonders of the world again, its beauty, its magnificence, and I knew what we are capable of, what we can do if we choose to. I was able to see the wonders of man, the architectural side. It's... Do you have any architecture? No? Okay. And the imaginational side of what we can see and perceive if we choose to. History. We must learn from the past so that we do not make the same mistakes in the future. That is vital as well. So after lots and lots of struggles and many beautiful sights, 10-hour days, 4-hour press runs, in every single stop, the Ministry of Tourism was actually coincided within one RTW for our Visit Malaysia 2014 program. The biggest press conference I got in a single sitting was 60 different press articles. That was in Calcutta, India. That was 60. Taipei said that I was the Asian version of Tom Cruise.
Who is this guy?
Which I didn't see how that actually worked. Japan, they call me James Kun. Yeah, James Kun. The Americans were great fun, you know. They took me out for meatloaf and everything. It was just amazing. But after 48 days, 21 countries, 43,000 kilometers, and a year of hard work, mommy? Yeah, a year of hard work. Oh, that's my mom, by the way. Wave, say hi. Yeah. It was done. We made it. We got back, and Malaysia had a world record. We got it. Not a world record. That Malaysia is the world record holder out of 123 different countries. We are number one. And that... Thank you. And that made me think. How can I be better? How can I improve myself? And this is the answer, right here. The legacy of our people. The legacy of Malaysia Bule and Satu Malaysia. And like I said, again, thank you, Segi. Because what you do, this institution is not for yourself, but for the future of this country. And all of you will be the future leaders of this country as well. So please keep it up. Keep working hard. And find your dream, and once you do, pursue it. Don't let anyone stop you. I got comments like, James, who wants to sponsor you? You are nothing. My birthday was coming, I was running out of time, I was running out of money, I was running out of everything, but I still got it done. Anything is possible if you choose to it. Sorry, if you choose to believe it. Any dream can become a possibility. All you need to do is believe in one thing, and one thing only. That it is possible. That it is possible. And anyways, for marketing site, like me on my Facebook page, 1RTW. And there's lots of videos in there, pictures of my different experiences. I'm going off to Alaska next month to do a training flight for my next next project. So please check it out, like it, tell your friends, share it with your friends. It's great fun. So write it down. Come on. Take a picture. Write it down. Don't be shy. It's okay. Thank you very much, and we have a few minutes for some questionnaires if anyone is interested. I actually believe in one thing, to actually empty the tank before actually going for it. And hi there. So always empty the tank before going off. What else? I had a little like a custom made thing, but it was a bottle, you know, it was just a fancy bottle, and that was about it. The fancy bottle, and then like on the flight suit, you have a zip on top and a zip on the bottom as well. So it was amazing. Any other questions?
So thank you. We talked over a lot of things, and we've gone through the game plan. What are the possibilities? What scenarios he could possibly get himself into? So we kind of I scaffolded that was the experience for him to go through. What would you do in this scenario? What would you do in this? So I was checking out, okay, whether he was mentally and physically prepared for this expedition. How did I feel when he was actually there, flying? I had my moments, yes. I lost a few hair and a few became gray. But we were in pretty relative, every other day kind of contact using WhatsApp. Great. Samsung. Great provider. So we were able to touch base, just making sure that he was physically and mentally staying on track for this type of expedition. Because I think one thing that wasn't pointed out, the previous record holder for this actually did it in 80 days, and the one before that was 96. James did it in 48. So not only was it a world record as in youngest, it was world record as in time frame. So it takes a lot out of you physically and mentally.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Take care, guys. Thank you for your time.
One at a time. Captain James Anthony Tan.